Throughout history, developments in Central Asia had deep impact on India. During the 10th and 12th centuries, it led to the advent of the Ghaznavids and the Ghurids. During the 15th and the early 16th centuries, turmoil in Central Asia led to a wave of new incursions. This time it led to the foundation of the Mughal Empire by Zahiruddin Muhammad Babur, which ruled India for the next 400 years. Babur came from a distinguished lineage. He was a descendant of Tamerlane and Genghis Khan. He succeeded to the small principality of Ferghana in 1494 at the tender age of 12. Brought up in the quagmire of Central Asia, he became acquainted to the harsh realities of power politics very early in his life. For 2 years, he waged a constant battle of intrigue and deception to retain the throne. During the next 10 years, Babur twice captured Samarkand, to lose it again after a short spell. He realized that his position in the region had become well nigh impossible. In a bold move, Babur crossed the Hindu Kush mountains in 1504 and captured Kabul and Ghazni. Like most powerful chieftains of Central Asia, his eyes moved towards India. His imagination had been fired by the tales of Taimur's exploits in India. He decided to recover the areas in the Punjab ceded to Taimur and held by his descendants for long. Babur led 5 expeditions into India between 1519 to 1524. At this juncture, India was rife with internal dissensions and lacked a strong effective power base. India seemed a tempting fruit ready for picking to the hardy warriors of Babur. In 1517, Ibrahim Lodhi, the last ruler of Delhi, ascended the throne. He was young and energetic, but lacked the tact to deal with old, well-established nobility. There was resentment amongst the local rulers against his unpopular rule. Daulat Khan, the Afghan governor of Punjab, approached Babur with an invitation to invade India. It seems that Babur also received an envoy from Rana Sanga. While Babur needed no invitation to attack, the arrival of these envoys convinced him that the situation was ripe for undertaking the conquest of India. Babur crossed the Rubicon when he launched his main invasion in the winter of 1524. His forces crossed the Indus over Attock. After effecting a major crossing on the Satluj River, Babur reached Ambala by March of 1526. He was now within striking range of Delhi at the site near Panipat, where the most notable battles in India's history had always been fought. Initially, Ibrahim Lodhi thought Babur was leading yet another plundering expedition. But now, Ibrahim realized the gravity of the situation and set his military machine, though rusty, in motion. Scholars are not unanimous about the strength of opposing forces. According to Babanama, Babur had 12,000 cavalry. Lieutenant Colonel Haig gives total strength as 25,000. The army was well organized in the units of 10, 50, 100, 500 and 1,000 along Timurid lines. The bulk of army consisted of cavalry, supplemented by Turkish gunners with gunpowder matchlocks and cannons. The cavalry consisted of horse archers. They were mainly Mongols recruited from Mughalistan in Central Asia. They were masters of ambushes, raiding, and feigned retreats. Horse archers wore full armor. Lamellar armor was in extensive use alongside chainmail plate hybrid armor. The deadliest weapon was the Turco-Mongol composite bow. It could shoot 3 times faster than a matchlock. It was accurate up to 70 to 100 yards. The composite bow was made from horn, wood and sinew laminated together. The horn is on the belly, facing the archer, and sinew on the outside. When the bow is drawn, the sinew which was stretched on the outside and horn, compressed inside, store more energy than wood for the same length of bow. The standard small arm in Babar's army was Tufang or matchlock musket. These guns were very similar to models used in the Ottoman Empire. The weapon had approximately the same range as composite bow, but its rate of fire was about a third as great. It was much easier to master than the composite bow. It could be fired while in prone or kneeling position, and from behind cover. Babar introduced field artillery in the Indian military history. His artillery had been honed under Master Ali Kuli, the Turkish artillery expert. Most of Babar's artillery was of two basic types. The Karzan, or heavy cannon, fired balls of about 25 to 30 pounds. It was carried on four-wheeled wagons with their barrels laid flat down the length of cart. It was very difficult to maneuver them. The gun barrel was fixed to carriage, making elevation and firing it at varying range extremely difficult. The smaller cannon, Zabazan, firing balls of 3 or 4 pounds mounted on two-wheeled carriage, was a more flexible option. All the guns in Babar's artillery train were cast from brass or bronze and fired stone shot. Their maximum range varied from 1600 yards to as much as 3 miles. Ibrahim Lodhi army had 1 lakh troops, comprising 40,000 cavalry, 60,000 infantry, and over 1,000 elephants. Only half the strength was irregular fighting troops. The armored elephant and horse formed the two pillars of Sultanate's military strength. The army was based on quasi-feudal structure. A small central force under the Sultan's direct control was supplemented by a large number of contingent brought by different feudal lords. The Afghans relied on heavy shock cavalry as the basis of their military power. The standard Malay cavalry had changed little since the early days of Sultanate. The primary shock force was armored elephants. As mobile fortress, they were a formidable force. They mounted a Mahabat with 2 to 3 infantry men with spears and bows. India's humid climate and the dominating presence of war elephants did not allow the development of heavily armed infantry in packed formation as in Europe. Infantry was very much cannon fodder. Babar's tactics at Panipat showed the influence of a mix of two military traditions, the Ottoman and the Mongol Timurid. Babar realized that since Ibrahim was commanding a bigger force, he might attempt to attack the Mughal flanks. Babar deployed his army with its right flank protected by the Panipat town. To protect the left flank, his army dug a ditch. At some places the ditch was covered with mud, in order to allow counterattack by a small group of about 200 cavalry each. To give added protection to the front line, and absorb the shock of Afghan assault, Babar set up an obstacle of over 700 carts yoked together in pairs across his entire front. Ali Kuli was ordered to join up these carts with ropes of raw hide. Each pair had a gap of around 4 meters between them. In breastworks behind these gaps were firing position, in which 6 to 7 musket men were concealed to fire through the gaps. In the center, and along the flanks, the heavy cannons had been deployed to hurl lethal volleys. As an added measure, a gap of 150 meters had been left at the flanks through which cavalry could maneuver and sally forth. This defensive deployment was typical Ottoman tactics for stopping enemy cavalry charge. Ali Kuli had witnessed the Battle of Chaudhrian in 1514 between Ottomans and Safavids of Persia, in which Ottomans used the same tactics with great success. Babar placed himself in the center of defense, where he could control the flow of events. The right wing was under the command of Prince Humayun, and left wing under Muhammad Mirza. To the rear he deployed his reserve, the Iltimish. it was a large force of his best cavalry. To this classical defensive deployment, Babur added his trump card, the Tulgumas. They were the squadrons of cavalry on the right and left flanks, which would sweep on from both flanks after the enemy was held by the center. The Uzbek tribes of Central Asia were adept at implementing the Tulguma tactic. Babur had learned it the hard way when Shivani Khan attacked his army in the same way in 1502. Lodhi's battle formation consisted of traditional five divisions, the vanguard, the right, the left, the center and the rear. The Sultan stood at the center with a picked body of cavalry. The Afghans based their battle tactics around the shock strike forces of their elephants and heavy cavalry. On 21 April 1526, the day was Friday, a holy day for Muslims. Ibrahim decided to try his luck and order to advance was given. The troops marched from their camp and without waiting to form up, went headlong into the attack. The result was carnage. Hemmed in by the obstacles created on both flanks, the attackers bunched up, providing an easy target for the cannon and musketeers. The Afghan war elephants were terrified by the unfamiliar noise of Mughal cannons, and they refused to advance further. The elephants, unnerved by the sound, turned and trampled back through the advancing rear ranks of Afghans. The entire assaulting wave was a seething mass of confused, disoriented warriors trapped in a confined space, unable to advance. They were merely cannon fodder for the archers and musketeers, which continued carnage at the standoff ranges. Babur simultaneously launched his true trump card, the two Tulgumas contingent. The turning parties galloping forward at high speeds, discharge arrows towards the flanks of the enemy. At this moment, Babur's force looked like two horns of a crescent attempting to swallow the Lodhi's army. Ibrahim felt the pressure of the Tulgumas and started retreating towards the center. The two Tulgumas linked up in the rear, effectively bottling the Afghans within their pincers. By midday, the battle was over. Ibrahim possessed the personal courage and he fought and died in the battlefield. Lodhi's death triggered general collapse and Afghans' rout. Babur's victory led to the end of the Delhi Sultanate and the establishment of the Mughal dynasty. Panipat had merely given him the foothold on the throne. To consolidate his rule, there would be more battles against more powerful enemies, which would define and chisel the contours of the new empire. But Panipat marked the beginning.